I said the Rock Island Line
is a mighty good road.
I said the Rock Island Line
is a road to ride.
I said the Rock Island Line
is a mighty good road.
If you want to ride, you got to ride it like you find. Buy your ticket at the station on the Rock Island Line.
Our story begins on the deck of this enormous ship. It's loaded with intermodal containers leaving a port some thousands of miles away. Modern container ships are among the largest in the world. They have the ability to carry millions upon millions of pounds of goods of every variety. Boasting a deadweight of about 160,000 tons, this ship is capable of carrying over 15,000 fully loaded intermodal containers all over the world. A ship of this size simply can't get up and leave. It will need help from this tugboat. Modern tugboats possess immense amounts of pulling power, power that will be utilized to help safely guide our ship out of the many hazards of the port and towards the open ocean. Now safely out of port, our container ship puts throttle to full and sets a course for its long and winding journey towards the United States. It's a dazzling morning in Savannah, Georgia, as evident by our sun-soaked container ship. It's currently concluding the very final leg of its long journey from Asia to America. Not even the strong currents of the Savannah River can stop this ship's mighty bulbous bow from cutting through the waves as it confidently glides towards its destination. Ships enjoy unrivaled global dominance in carrying capacity. There simply isn't a cheaper and more efficient way to move vast amounts of goods across large distances. Accordingly, the world has come to rely on large container ships to keep their economies sailing forward. Statistics say 90% of everything travels by ship, and I believe that this cargo-laden Costco container ship is an ironclad testament to these claims. There's one question that still remains. Where does a ship of this size go to unload? Well, the answer lies just downstream of us, underneath the bridge and beyond the cranes. A tugboat will be guiding us to our destination today. It will be leading us under Savannah's 185-foot Talmadge River Bridge, one of the highest spans in the state of Georgia. For our container ship, this bridge is the final challenge it must surmount with inches to spare before it reaches its final destination of the mighty port of Savannah. One of the busiest container ports in the U.S., the port is able to handle dozens of enormous ships each day, utilizing over 10,000 feet of continuous berthing space. Once docked, the port can unload ships using their 36 post and super post Panamax container cranes. It's in part thanks to these cranes that the port of Savannah is able to handle over 4 million containers unloaded and loaded each and every year. These containers come from a variety of domestic and international ports, carrying an enormous variety of cargo. Case in point, this frozen goods container ship, which transports highly specialized refrigerated intermodal containers. The bulk of Savannah's massive ships, however, are carrying normal goods that we use and enjoy each and every day. From televisions to toys, from kitchen supplies to furniture, it's all unloaded from ships like the Clementine Maersk. The port's large post-Panamax cranes will then get busy lifting hundreds of containers off the deck of the ship and onto container trucks. These trucks will then take the containers to large staging areas where they await pickup by train. Ships may be the fastest way to move containers by sea, but on land, trains dominate. Here at the Norfolk Southern Intermodal Terminal, there's constant movement of container traffic. Containers awaiting transport are put in the large, specifically organized piles. Here they will be picked up by large railroad container trains and placed onto the appropriate rail car. Perched high in the air, the operators of these special container cranes have a bird's eye view of all the action unfolding below. It's the skill of these operators which allows them to unload and load hundreds of intermodal containers on and off awaiting trains each and every day. It takes teamwork to make a container port run efficiently, teamwork which these operators and their truck drivers have in abundance. Let's watch as our crane operator slowly but securely lifts this container off the back of a special yard dog container truck. Once the operator is certain that his load is secure, he will readjust the container's position on the crane, and then slide down towards the appropriate rail car in which this container will be placed for its outward bound journey. It takes immense amounts of skill to be able to perform this job properly. Operators must be able to precisely spot their loads over the exact right position before they are permitted to lower their load into the well car. Keep in mind that this container won't be riding solo. Chances are it will have a buddy riding right on top of it, piggyback style. For this reason, it's paramount that the crane operator secures his load properly. One unsecure container can spell absolute disaster for a railroad. It's a good thing then that these crane operators are some of the finest in the world. Their skill allows hundreds of containers to be safely loaded onto awaiting intermodal trains each and every day. And with our train now fully loaded, it's finally time for us to get underway on the main line. Every day, the nation's Class 1 railroads carry millions of intermodal containers across thousands of miles of busy mainline track. These intermodal trains are one of the backbones of the American economy, as they safely and efficiently transport millions of pounds of goods everywhere across the United States. For this to be possible, the nation's biggest and busiest railroads, known as the Class 1s, work together to create an integrated intermodal transportation network all across the United States, Mexico, and Canada. Because of such collaboration, it is not uncommon to see locomotives belonging to different railroads on the same train. Known in the industry as foreign or run-through power, this increasingly common phenomenon is a wonderful way to become acquainted with some of America's biggest and most storied railroads. These Class 1s include the likes of Atlanta-based Norfolk Southern, Jacksonville-based CSX, Montreal-based Canadian National, Fort Worth-based BNSF, Kansas City-based Kansas City Southern, and Omaha's very own Union Pacific. Metaphorically speaking, these mighty railroads are the motive power which push our economy and nation forward. But literally speaking, there'd be no movement at all without the railroad's biggest and most important asset, their enormous fleets of locomotives. Without high-performing locomotives, American railroads would simply come grinding to a halt. Therefore, it's paramount that these mighty machines are kept in tip-top performing condition. And to do this, they go to a very special place. Welcome to Norfolk Southern's mighty Junietta Locomotive Shops, located in Altoona, Pennsylvania. Originally built in 1850 by the Pennsylvania Railroad, Junietta Shops is one of the largest locomotive facilities in the world today. Owned by the Norfolk Southern, the railroad uses it as the center of its locomotive repair and rebuilding program. Because of its enormous size, Junietta Shops is capable of repairing and handling hundreds of locomotives each and every day. And to accomplish this task efficiently and safely, Junietta relies on the classic piece of railroad hardware, the turntable.
It is one of our most dependable locomotives that we use here at Tennessee Valley.
The job of a turntable is pretty self-explanatory. Simply, it's to turn a train, car, or locomotive around. What the name doesn't tell you, however, is that turntables are in fact highly engineered machines of precision, which once upon a time, and even today, like here at the Tennessee Valley Railroad Museum, serves as one of the most important pieces of railway infrastructure a railroad can possess. Guided by an outer rail and powered by a steam motor, electric motor, or sometimes even a hand crank, turntables have to be able to smoothly transport the weight of a multi-ton locomotive to the proper track. Once aligned with the desired track, the turntable must then be able to both keep still, aligned, and balanced as the locomotive slowly crawls its way off the turntable and onto the corresponding track. It's thanks to old innovations like the turntable that new and modern facilities like Junietta Shops are able to keep Norfolk Southern's locomotives rolling. And boy, there are a lot of them. It seems everywhere you look in Altoona, there's a locomotive awaiting repair. In addition to repair, Altoona also handles Norfolk Southern's extensive rebuild and revitalization program of outdated, broken down, or worn out locomotives. Much of a locomotive's machinery can be retooled and refurbished for later use. However, for other components, such as this plow, it's simpler and cheaper to order them new from a manufacturer. And what's a locomotive without its wheels? Here in Altoona, hundreds of sets await their turn to be refurbished for later use. Yes, indeed, the Altoona of today is a vibrant place, buzzing with railroad activity. However, for the historian, Altoona is a place that's teeming with vintage railroad equipment and history. Case in point, this former Southern Railway High Hood locomotive. The Southern Railway was the railway which proudly proclaimed to serve the South. And to do this, they relied on a fleet of specially designed GP38-2 High Hood locomotives. Noted for their lack of front-facing windows, this design was chosen by the Southern due to its operational resemblance to steam locomotives. The Southern's predecessor, the Norfolk Southern, still operates a few High Hood locomotives up and down the line. But as for the rest of the High Hoods, most of them have been relegated to the pages of history and can only be found in the extensive deadlines of Norfolk Southern. A deadline is a line of locomotives which are just that, dead and inoperational. These trains are usually being used for parts or awaiting their turn to head to the scrapyard. Deadlines offer a historical portrait of the vintage and derelict equipment of yesterday and the new and modern motive power of the railroad of today. The Norfolk Southern is one of the largest railroads in the world. Because of this, they have a lot of dead and derelict equipment. Every available space at Junietta Shops is occupied by a locomotive. Travel to any major yard or destination on the Norfolk Southern system, you're pretty much guaranteed to encounter a deadline of some length and size. All this equipment will be dealt with eventually, but right now, Norfolk Southern just can't be bothered. So, till they figure out what to do with these trains, they sit here, stuck in a railroad limbo, awaiting their fate. But with so much equipment clogging up Norfolk Southern's yards and maintenance facilities, the railroad is sometimes forced to let nature take its course on the rust-blanketed tracks of sleepy Thomaston, Georgia. Buried deep within the brush of this small central Georgia town are some of Norfolk Southern's most ambient deadlines. Once king of the East Coast's extensive rail network, now these locomotives are only king of the place in which they sit. These former Kansas City Southern and Norfolk Southern trains are now owned by Progress Rail Leasing Company. The future may be a little bit brighter for these locomotives than the ones we saw in Altoona. Many of these trains will likely be sold off or leased to other railroads in need of surplus equipment. Because after all, you can't run a railroad without its locomotives.
Ah!
Another important thing railroads are reliant upon is their vast amounts of infrastructure. Any successful railroad owes its success to the infrastructure it uses to get trains from point A to point B safely, quickly, and efficiently. Some examples of infrastructure include Greenville's Saluda River Trestle Bridge, or the 3,612-foot Gallitzin Tunnel, which cuts through the heart of the Allegheny Mountains. Or perhaps the world-famous engineering marvel that is Altoona, Pennsylvania's Horseshoe Curve. Constructed by the Pennsylvania Railroad in 1854 at an intrepid 1.45% grade, the Horseshoe Curve is one of America's most important pieces of rail infrastructure. So important, in fact, that it was the target of a failed German saboteur effort during the Second World War. Now, just why is this curve in particular so important? Because it's one of the crucial pieces of infrastructure which allows the Norfolk Southern to bridge the mighty Allegheny Mountains and connect the cities of Pittsburgh to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and points east such as Philadelphia, New York City, and Boston. The brakes of this loaded grain train will be squealing all the way downhill to Altoona, Pennsylvania. And with that 1.45% downhill grade, it takes years of training and experience for engineers to be able to safely handle trains down this mountain. Training which they will receive at Norfolk Southern's state-of-the-art facilities at McDonough, Georgia's Norfolk Southern Training Center. It's here where Norfolk Southern will send their fresh batches of recruits to learn the basics and fundamentals of how to safely operate on a railroad. And with an extensive campus, McDonough has everything a fledgling railroader may need to learn how to switch cars, operate locomotives, read signals, change tracks, and anything in between. Unfortunately, no amount of training can change the fact that railroading is one of the most hazardous jobs in the world. That's why Norfolk Southern's intensive hands-on curriculum uses live road equipment. On the railroad, there's no substitute for real-world experience. That's why McDonough strives to prepare its crews adequately for the real thing. Learned a little bit about how trains work, what makes them move, and the infrastructure they use to get from point A to point B. But what do trains carry? What kind of trains are there? Well, I think it's time we take a look at some of the cargo you may see riding the rails of the United States. Finishing off strong is this scrap metal unit train. A unit train is a type of train that consists of only one kind of cargo. More often than not, unit trains serve industries that ship and receive large amounts of a single type of good. Case in point, this lumbering lumber train, carrying freshly cut logs from lumber mills across Tennessee. These logs are being shipped to lumber processing facilities, which will turn these lowly logs into products such as building wood and paper. Once those goods are ready to be shipped, they will be loaded onto a manifest train. Before the intermodal container revolution, manifest traffic was the backbone of every major freight railroad's operations. These manifests, or general merchandise trains, carry every conceivable cargo to be found on the railroad, often in colorful boxcars filled to the brim with goods. Sometimes, however, goods are too big to fit within the confines of a boxcar. In this case, they're plopped onto the back of specially designed flat cars. The load flexibility afforded by these flat cars means that America's manifest trains are able to haul practically anything, including this monolithic Caterpillar bulldozer. Whenever that tractor does arrive at its destination, chances are it will be used for farm work. The very farm work that produces and ships millions of tons of grain by rail each day. The nation's stomach quite literally runs on rails, as most of the food we enjoy each and every day begins the journey to your stomach from within one of these hundreds of grain hopper cars. The grain in this train will be processed, packaged, sold, consumed, digested, and eventually thrown away. And just what does America do with its waste? Why, we put it on a trash train. Trash trains transport the nation's waste product from cities and towns to faraway landfills and processing facilities. But not all train hauled trash is landfill bound. The railroad is a safe way to transport hazardous and toxic waste in specially designed containers to disposal facilities across the nation. Much of this hazardous waste originates from another railroad transported commodity, cars. Auto rack unit trains carry the nation's automobile supply from port to distributor to even dealership. But don't think trains are just limited to civilian vehicles. The machines of war are also transported via rail, making trains a crucial part of America's military and defense. Despite their intimidating appearance, tank-laden military trains aren't the only kind of train of national importance. Oversized and heavy load trains are often the only way to carry large power generators and other pieces of electrical infrastructure to the places they're needed. To prevent track damage, special load-distributing heavyweight flat cars are used to transport large and overweight items such as the Siemens Energy electrical generators. Even once unloaded and installed, these electrical generators will still be reliant upon trains to keep them supplied with the cheap and abundant source of energy that is coal. Although well into its decline, being replaced by newer and cleaner sources of energy, coal is nevertheless one of the most profitable commodities trains carry today. And even though what they haul may be from a bygone era, that doesn't mean coal trains are any less impressive rumbling by. This fully loaded coal train alone is carrying enough energy to power an entire small town for a year. But how does coal get from being underground to powering a town? Well, it all starts here. The coal is mined and quickly sent to prep plants, such as this one here in Portage, Pennsylvania. There, it will be cleaned and processed before being loaded into awaiting coal trains. Fully laden with energy, these coal trains are power plant bound. Some of the largest of these are coal powered, such as TVA Kingston, which at one time was the single largest coal burning power plant in the world, generating approximately 10 billion kilowatt hours a year by burning over 14,000 tons of coal each day. That's approximately 140 fully loaded coal cars, which the Norfolk Southern has to supply each and every day. But wait a minute, you say? That's not a Norfolk Southern locomotive on the head of that coal train? Well, you'd be both right and wrong. It's a Norfolk Southern train, but painted in a special heritage scheme to celebrate the railroads of the past that came together to make the modern Norfolk Southern of today. Norfolk Southern has 20 heritage units in total, celebrating the legacy of rail giants such as Conrail. The Lehigh Valley. The Central of Georgia. The Pennsylvania Railroad. And of course, the Nickel Plate. But Norfolk Southern isn't alone in celebrating their histories. Every Class 1 railroad has a heritage unit of some sort to celebrate their past. You know, in their own unique way, the coal trains of today are like heritage units. These once dominant trains are slowly becoming relics of a distant, forgotten time as the U.S. moves to switch to more sustainable and efficient sources of energy. We've talked about coal, manifest, ethanol, and intermodal, but all those trains would be useless if not for the tracks that carry them from place to place. America has an estimated 140,000 miles of train track, and to ensure that railroads can operate safely and efficiently, each and every piece of that track must be regularly inspected and maintained. The FRA requires that railroads inspect their track on a bi-weekly basis. To accomplish this mammoth task, railroads use special high-railer pickup trucks, which are equipped with conventional road and train wheels. Sometimes a visual inspection isn't enough to spot microscopic flaws in railroad tracks. For that task, the railroads rely on their geometry trains. A geometry train is a specialized piece of railroading equipment utilizing an arsenal of computers and sensors. The geometry train searches for microscopic track flaws and defects that cannot be seen by the human eye. Affectionately known as the brick, those two strange-looking railcars have the capability to test and inspect hundreds of miles of railroad track, all while traveling at maximum authorized speed. Anywhere a normal train will travel, so too does the geometry train. From lift bridges to high-flying trestles, and through the dark recesses of mile-long tunnels, to thousands upon thousands of miles of track. It's up to track inspectors in the geometry train to ensure our track looks like this, and not like this. Even so, after years of wear and tear from weather and trains, tracks will inevitably need to be replaced. And no matter if it's a short track segment or a mile-long piece of ribbon rail, there's one place all railroads turn to rejuvenate their supplies of steel rails. Welcome to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the steel capital of the United States. Everywhere you go in Pittsburgh, there are relics of its industrial history. After all, Pittsburgh was the steel capital of America, with over 300 steel-related industries found within the limits of the city. And even though much of the steel industry has long since moved overseas, the relics of Pittsburgh's past are still highly visible. From the white-hot forges and furnaces, which helped produce 95 million tons of steel yearly, to the monolithic pieces of machinery, which turn that raw steel into useful product. One does not need to search very long at all before they stumble across a towering piece of industrial history, such as the steel stacks of Homestead, Pennsylvania. Built by steel tycoon Andrew Carnegie in the 1800s, these 12 furnace smokestacks were once part of the largest steel mill in the world, a steel mill which was also home to one of the single most important days in American labor history. It was here, on the morning of July 6, 1892, on the orders of the Carnegie Steel Company, 300 Pinkerton agents attempted to land near this pump house, where union steelworkers were on strike protesting unfair wage cuts by Henry Clay Frick. The clash between the strikers and the Pinkertons resulted in 7 workers and 3 Pinkertons being killed. It ultimately took over 8,000 state militia to break up the strike, in an event that would have resounding impacts on American union and labor history for years to come. It's consequential history like this that makes Pittsburgh stand out among American cities. A history that's deeply intertwined with one of Pittsburgh's most important customers and greatest assets. Its railroads. After all, it was Pittsburgh's steel that was laid down to form the high iron. But today, much of a railroad's track is made on site at major train yards and facilities such as Norfolk Southern's Inman Yard. It's here where track is manufactured to be utilized on repair and maintenance projects all across the Norfolk Southern system. Locating rail facilities at a major rail yard allows the NS to be able to send out much-needed track onto its system in a short amount of time. When an order is received, track will be manufactured and sorted onto specialized rail cars before being transported to its destination by one of Norfolk Southern's specialized rail trains. When tracks need maintenance or replacement, railroads utilize a series of specialized work trains to get the job done. We are, of course, already well acquainted with the continuous welded rail trains, which carry tracks to their final destination. But without the help of a company ballast train, which transports the gravel you see train tracks sitting upon, our rail would have nothing to anchor itself to the ground to. Rail maintenance company Herzog often provides ballast trains, but its job isn't done when the gravel hits the ground. That ballast needs to be spread by something, and that something is the Herzog Multi-Purpose Rail Maintenance Machine. Possessing an entire fleet of these custom-built contraptions, the Herzog Multi-Purpose Machine is like the Swiss Army knife of railroad construction. Its most notable asset would be the excavator, which rides piggyback on top of custom-built railed flat cars. Those rails allow the excavator to move around like a mini train on top of a train. And that, along with an excavator's versatility and wide range of tool attachments, is why the multi-purpose machine is such a valued piece of railroad repair infrastructure. Herzog's fleet of multi-purpose machines are utilized by every major Class 1 railroad, along with many Class 2 and 3 roads as well. Because of this busy schedule, the multi-purpose machines have to do a lot of traveling. And to aid with their travels, they rely on specially rebuilt EMD locomotives. It's these strange-looking steel stallions which allow the Herzog multi-purpose machine to be completely autonomous, not requiring any other railroad's locomotive to transport it around. It can get itself from point A to point B quickly and efficiently, and it's this self-reliance which might just be its greatest asset of all. Clearly, the multi-purpose machine is a notable piece of railroad maintenance equipment, but despite its significance, it's still just one of hundreds of different pieces of maintenance equipment that are utilized to repair train track. Unlike our self-reliant Herzog multi-purpose machine, most maintenance equipment has to hitch a ride to the job site on the back of special work trains. The Class 1 railways of the United States have a lot of rail to maintain. Therefore, it's logical that the cheapest and most efficient way to get all the equipment and supplies needed to rail maintenance and construction projects is via the railroad itself. These company maintenance of way trains transport everything that can possibly be carried on the back of a train to the construction site. From boxcars filled with supplies and handheld tools, to foremen and administrative trailers, to flat cars loaded with every conceivable piece of maintenance of way equipment imaginable. Each one of these maintenance of way machines is precisely engineered to serve a specific job in the railroad construction process. Without the operations and capabilities of one machine, the other machines would not be able to complete their various tasks in the construction process. So, when the maintenance of way train comes to a halt at its destination, the equipment will be unloaded and sorted into a specific order based on its function in the construction process. Once in order, the line of maintenance of way equipment will make its way down the track, conducting repairs as they go. One of the most common forms of railroad repair is tie replacement projects. Often made from specially treated wood and exposed to the elements, railroad ties will eventually rot. Therefore, they have to be replaced. Let's take a look at how this is done using this special maintenance of way tie replacer. The claw first grabs a pre-placed railroad tie before shoving it under the tracks and through the ballast. Then it tamps it down into place before going to the next railroad tie and continuing the process. To keep the tracks from shifting, every other tie is replaced by this machine. Then, another machine will come along and spike the tracks down to the wood. Only once these ties are securely anchored to the track can the process start all over again with the ties that were originally passed over. Ahead of the tie replacer is this maintenance of way crane, which is currently organizing and placing railroad ties. The maintenance of way parade is a delicate balance of timing and skill. If this crane didn't place its ties just so, and at just the right moment, then the tie replacer wouldn't be able to do its job, and so on and so forth. All this precision must be maintained while trains are still operating just inches away on the active track. Yet maintenance of way crews don't shy down. They are skilled and trained professionals who know the importance of their work in ensuring that trains are able to operate safely and on time 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. We've come a long way in our railroad journey, and so has our intermodal train. It's enjoyed being one of the dispatcher's top priorities as it's wound its way through America. But for the first time since her departure, we suddenly find ourselves losing speed from 60 miles per hour to 50, 40, 30, and now we're approaching 20. And eventually, we grind to a halt. What's going on? Why would our train, with such important commerce on board, be stopped in its tracks? Well, To put it simply, we've been told to wait. It doesn't matter that we're pulled by some of America's finest locomotives or that we're carrying some of America's most valuable rail cargo. In the United States, there's only one train with a higher priority than intermodal: passenger rail. All aboard Amtrak! The mighty Southern Crescent is making its way north towards New York City, filled with excited passengers ready to hit the Big Apple. And those passengers don't want to be delayed. Therefore, on every major Class 1 railroad, the name of the game is not to delay the Amtrak train. Amtrak and passenger trains crisscross the nation, serving hundreds of unique destinations. From the humbly determined Pennsylvanian, to the blistering speed of the Northeast Regional, from the workhorses of the nation's commuter rails, to the fury of America's fastest train, America's passenger railroads are determined to succeed and to get you quickly to where you need to be. You think this train's impressive? Man, you should have seen them back in the day. Before the automobile dominated the land and airplanes dominated the sky, passenger railroads reigned supreme as the dominant mode of transportation. No matter where you wanted to go, short or far, there was a train that could take you there. And it wasn't just a hop-on, hop-off affair. Trains were the epitome of style and class during the day, and their passenger equipment reflected this. It's still possible to see some of these famous trains over at the Tennessee Valley Railroad Museum. From the elegant and sleek Southern Railway streamlined diesels, which pulled their flagship Crescent train, to the luxurious passenger cars, which carried patrons in style. You just don't see equipment like this on today's railroads, except on one train. Norfolk Southern's Office Car Special. Forget the private jets and the fancy cars. If you're in charge of a major Class 1 railroad, the Office Car Special is the only way to travel. The flagship of the Norfolk Southern, this titan of luxury is used to transport railroad executives, conduct important railroad business on the go, and charm potential customers in the elegance and style only afforded by rail. It takes some extraordinary locomotives to pull such an extraordinary train. Locomotives like these custom-built and immaculately maintained SD-60Es. Following the locomotives is a regular who's who of legacy and vintage rail equipment hailing from the golden days of American passenger railroading. Each car was rescued from the former fleets of rail giants such as the New York Central and expertly refurbished. Every car on the OCS has a different tale to tell, but my personal favorite would have to be the theater observation car. The car trails the end of the train, affording passengers unparalleled views of scenery as it flies by. In this way, the OCS has become one of Norfolk Southern's most lucrative trains, able to effortlessly demonstrate the benefits of utilizing the NS Rail Freight Network. Freight cars of every shape, size, color, and configuration thunder down the line. These train cars are carrying the goods, materials, and commodities that fuel, feed, and form the foundations of our nation's economy. But one fundamental question still lingers. Where are these trains headed? What is their destination, and what will become of the goods they are carrying? All the answers we seek lie here at major train yards like Chattanooga's DeBoots Yard. The nexus of a rail freight network, train yards have a variety of important uses. Major centers like DeBoots Yard handle every kind of freight train carrying every kind of cargo imaginable. After all, it's at these train yards where mainline freights begin, end, or pause their journey for crew changes. And it's only the hottest of high-priority freights that pass through. But don't let this hustling intermodal train fool you. Concealed by the towering stacks of intermodal containers is one of the busiest locations on the railroad today. The 24-hour nonstop action of the train yard. The tracks are buzzing with activity here at the northern end of DeBoots Yard. As major mainline freights enter the yard, yard locomotives shuffle about organizing train cars into appropriate tracks. DeBoots is the second largest classification yard on the Norfolk Southern system. A classification yard is where incoming freight cars are organized and sorted onto appropriate trains, headed out locally or back on to the main line. Mainline unit and manifest trains are responsible for bringing train cars from all over the Norfolk Southern system to the yard for sorting. Once dropped off, a team from the yard's extensive fleet of locomotives will spot the cars into the appropriate sorting track, where depending on the train car's ultimate destination, it will either be picked up by another mainline freight train bound for the next major city or yard along the system, or if the train car's final destination is in the Chattanooga area, it will be spotted onto a local freight train tasked with delivering it and numerous other cars to local and regional customers dotted all along the line. Despite being competitors, America's freight rail network is reliant upon the cooperation of Class 1 railroads for efficient operation. For this reason, transfer runs are also made between railroads from major yards. Here we can see the CSX Railroad head into Irondale, Alabama's Norris Yard. It's carrying cars which started their journey on the CSX, but will end on the Norfolk Southern. In exchange, the Norfolk Southern will send locomotive crews to pick up and drop off freight at the CSX. It's this inter-railroad cooperation which allows goods to seamlessly flow from one side of the country to the other, all without ever having to worry about which railroad they're using to get there. To intermodal trains, classification yards are an antiquated technology meant for the likes of manifest and mainline unit trains. It's a far more efficient place that our train is headed to. Atlanta, Georgia's How Why is a regular labyrinth of tracks, a labyrinth which this intermodal train is beginning to navigate. Coming in hot via Norfolk Southern's Greenville District, this intermodal is fully laden with international cargo which originated from the port of Charleston, South Carolina. For the engineer of this train, it's the end of a long night shift on the Norfolk Southern. However, for the engineer of this other intermodal heading towards us, their day is just getting started. They are currently in the process of building out their train. In other words, backing on to loaded cuts of intermodal well cars, pulling up forward, and then backing on to another cut. This process will continue until the entire train is assembled, inevitably requiring each train move to be longer than the last. By the time this train is ready to go, it will be almost a mile in length, fully loaded with intermodal containers bound for destinations across the nation. The greatest asset possessed by a locomotive engineer is their patience. The task of building a train takes a very long time to complete, as crews have to carefully switch tracks and couple up cars. But with millions of dollars of goods on the line, the engineer need not fret. It's the railroad's top priority to ensure that intermodal trains are able to be loaded and unloaded efficiently and on time. This task is handled at Atlanta, Georgia's very own Inman Yard Intermodal Rail Facility. It's Norfolk Southern's massive Inman Yard and the adjacent Austell Intermodal Facility that handles the bulk of Atlanta's intermodal traffic. And it's here in Atlanta where, at long last, our intermodal journey will come to an end. With Atlanta customers awaiting their shipments, our train's Atlanta-bound containers are carefully unloaded by the very same type of container train that we saw at the Port of Savannah. It's this uniformity in equipment and procedure which makes intermodal transportation possible, ensuring that both the crane and the truck this container's being lowered onto will be compatible with the container. After traveling thousands of miles by boat and rail, the only thing that stands between this container and its destination is a short truck ride. Who knows? Maybe once the container is delivered, unpacked, and its products are placed on shelves, you'll visit the store to purchase one of those products. And on the drive home with your new treasure in hand, you and the product can finally rest easy knowing that the journey is finally over.